Okay, well, once again, we hope the technology is working. Welcome to chapter 16. We're going to talk about sound. This little section, this third week, we're talking about chapter 16. Chapter 17 is electricity and magnetism. Chapter 18 is machines. These are fun chapters. There's a lot that can be done in the book. There are a lot of great videos that you can find on YouTube for these things. Hopefully it's fun. I hope to be able to complete this video quickly and get it out to you. I'm driving for 4 hours today as part of our travels, and so I'm just trying to quickly get this before the kids wake up. So I feel really bad that we didn't talk about light, that I didn't get to that video. But light is a very strange thing because it's particles that have no apparent mass. Photons of light are carrying energy. It's a quantum, which is one photon of light is one quantum, which is the most basic packet of energy that we can describe. And here come these photons of light, bouncing off of my head, hitting me at the speed of light. Millions and millions of them. The light bulbs above my head are a source of light. So as electricity passes through the filament, it's emitting energy in the form of light. It's emitting energy in the form of heat too. If I go and grab the light bulb, it's going to be hot. So that's light, and it always travels zoom, really fast, speed of light, zoom, 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 several times around the world, 70 times around the world in a second, ridiculous speeds. Sound is different. It's also energy. It's carrying energy. It's also traveling in waves, but it's vibrating materials. And so if there were no air molecules between me and the microphone, you would have no sound coming from me. I have to vibrate air. So this vibration gets picked up by the microphone, which is then converting it to an electrical signal at your end. It's vibrate. There's a speaker that's changing it back to analog, that's physically vibrating the air. And these little vibrations, these little waves, are bouncing against your eardrum and making it go vibrate and sending those vibrations into your inner ear. The crazy thing is how sensitive your ears are. Incredibly sensitive. So it sounds to you like I'm speaking normally, but the amount of vibration that you're picking up is tiny, tiny, tiny. When somebody whispers, you can detect sound that vibrates your eardrum less than the width of a single atom. So I have no idea how it is that we can pick up such minute vibrations, but your ears are amplifying devices. And the middle ear, the bones of the middle ear, it amplifies sound about 20 times. And then the hair cells in your inner ear, they're just extremely sensitive. So your sense of hearing is actually the most sensitive of your senses. You think about the lightest touch that you can detect, or the smallest amount of light that you can detect. Sound, your ability to detect sound is quite a bit more sensitive than those other senses. It also has the broadest range. The amount of sound that you can tolerate before it's painful is millions of times greater than the smallest sound that you can detect. So that's pretty interesting. Sound vibrates. We're used to thinking of it as transmitting through the air, but sounds transmit through water. They transmit through solids. And actually, the vibrations carry better through solids. You may have seen an old cowboy movie or something where the Indian puts the knife in the ground and puts his ear against the knife and says, 20 men on horseback coming this way or something. Well, that's a real thing. They actually did. They would use the vibrations of the ground to be able to hear over longer distances. So sticking the knife into the ground and then the knife against your own bones, you can pick up vibrations from greater distance. I don't recommend you put your head on a train track But if you did, you'd be able to pick up the vibrations, the sound of the train much farther away than waiting for the sound to come through the air. Elephants have very low frequency calls, lower than we can hear, and they call really deep sounds, and they travel through these deep low frequency sounds travel through the earth, and elephants can communicate over great distances that way. Okay, so moving along, I better change to another slide here, and I should put more slides in, but we just don't have the time to redo all the slides right now. Okay, so sound is produced when any material vibrates, and that's a little bit misleading because we just got through saying that materials are always vibrating, right? There's energy in them, and temperature is a measure of the vibration of those molecules and atoms within the material. That's a disorganized sort of vibration. And sound is waves of vibration traveling through. The question, does a tree falling in the forest make any sound? Well, according to my definition of sound, because I'm defining it by the vibrations that are caused by the object, not by whether or not there's something that can interpret those vibrations, something that can receive those vibrations and say, oh yeah, I hear it. So if nobody hears it, did it still make a sound? Yes, it still made a sound. The bigger question is, if a man speaks his mind in the forest and there's no woman to hear him, is he still wrong? Now, that's a silly t-shirt that I saw, heard about. Okay, so my definition is the sound is the vibrations that are made, regardless of whether there's a person or an animal or anything else that can detect those vibrations. So, yeah, it's not dependent on the receiver. Now, for you to be able to hear something, the vibrations need to be there, and your equipment needs to be working for you to hear it, and your brain needs to be able, you know, working to interpret it. Because it's just vibrations. And that just bends the hair cells, and that just sends an electrical signal to your brain. And it doesn't mean it's sound. It doesn't mean that there's any sense to it, but your brain makes sense of it, which is pretty remarkable. Okay, so here comes sound waves, and it's compressions of the air, literally, and these tiny little compressions, and they move very quickly, not the speed of light. The speed of sound is much, much, much lower than the speed of light. It's still pretty fast, but, you know, if you see a plane moving very quickly, and then you hear, you know, afterwards, it's like, wait, the sound is over here, the plane is over there, it doesn't match up, because the data are coming to you different times. The light waves bouncing off the plane and coming to your head, they're coming to you very, very fast, immediately, essentially. The sound waves take longer. Or you see a flash of lightning and it takes several seconds before you hear the thunder, because they're traveling to you. They happened at the same time. Boom, you know, lightning and thunder at the same time, but it takes longer for the thunder to get to your ear than it does for the lightning to get to your eyes. So your outer ear, your pinna, collects the sounds, directs it into your ear canal or auditory canal, and vibrates your eardrum, this tympanic membrane. And then you have the malleus, incus, and stapes, this hammer, anvil, and stirrup, these little bones, and you're going from a larger window here, larger membrane here, to a very small oval window here. This is labeled as elliptical, but an oval window on the inner ear. And this transmission, this is just a mechanical amplifier. Like I said, it amplifies it about 20 times. These three little tubes that go at three different planes of direction, those are for your balance and sense of balance and movement. The sound, the vibrations are sent here into the cochlea, which looks like a snail shell, and basically the different frequencies stimulate hair cells at different points in the cochlea. And then there's an auditory nerve that transmits an electrical signal to the brain saying, these are the data that I'm getting from these hair cells. There's more we could say about the ear, but moving along. So speed of sound, 1 kilometer in 3 seconds, or 1 mile in 5 seconds. 1 mile in 5 seconds, as opposed to light, which is 186,000 miles in 1 second. 186,000 miles in 1 second compared to, you know, 0.2 of a mile in a second. So sound is really, really, really slow compared to light. The sound will travel a little faster in warm air, a little slower in cool air. It travels much faster in water and even faster in solids. So faster and farther. Okay, basically it's compressing the materials that it's passing through and causing little waves. Compressions is where things are being brought closer together. In between the compressions is called the rarefaction, where the particles are spread out. And there's some good videos online where people are playing with slinkies and ropes and things to talk about waves. So you might want to look for that. There's the wavelength, the frequency, and the amplitude. And these are things about waves that it applies to any waves. The wavelength, you know, from a crest to a crest. Do we have a picture of that? You know, here's a crest, that's the wavelength. Here's a crest here, that's a wavelength. This is a shorter wavelength than this one. A shorter wavelength, let's go back up here, means that it's a higher frequency. The frequency is the number of waves that pass a point in 1 second. So assuming these are going to be moving essentially the same speed, but the frequency, you know, if I'm standing here and these waves are passing me by and I'm counting them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you know, we have from here to here, you know, here it would be 1, 2, 3 waves. And in that same distance, we'd have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 6 waves. So the frequency is just basically how close together. A high frequency sound, the waves are going to be close together, and so many of them are going to pass at a time. Now, the pitch, you know, high frequency, high, low frequency, low. That's just how it works. Amplitude is the amount of energy in a sound wave. Okay, so frequency versus amplitude. This is essentially the intensity. So high amplitude, think of this as going up and down more. So the frequency doesn't change, but the amplitude is how high does it go and how low does it go, boom, boom. So I could have the same frequency, but a different amplitude. And a higher amplitude, this bigger, you know, the wave, whoa, whoa, whoa. That higher amplitude is going to be interpreted by my brain as a louder sound, a stronger vibration. And you could, so in other words, if you don't change the frequency, you're not changing the pitch. So, okay. And who knows, I can't keep a pitch. So, excuse me there, but changing the volume without changing the pitch, that's a function of the amplitude. So amplitude's a measure of kind of the amount of energy in that sound wave. And you play with this all the time, you know, on your volume settings. You're changing the amplitude. Now frequency, radio waves are either AM or FM. The Border Blaster radio that was stationed in Acuna, that the, you know, that Wolfman Jack used, that was an AM radio transmission, which was amplitude modification, and as opposed to frequency modulation. So without going into how radios work exactly, just know that that there were two basic ideas for having different radio stations. You could transmit, you could modify the amplitude and have amplitude modulation, or the frequency and have frequency modulation. So when you tune your radio dial on the FM, you're looking at different frequencies. On the AM dial, you're looking at different amplitudes of the radio waves. Not that that makes a lot of sense, just saying it, but at least now you know that FM is for frequency modulation and AM is amplitude modulation. Okay, three characteristics of sound. The quality of those characteristics of sound which allow the ear to distinguish sounds which have the same pitch and loudness. Same pitch and loudness. So it seems like, how would you distinguish it? Fundamental tone and overtones. Oh boy. I'm kind of just, you know, I haven't even gone through these slides. I'm just talking quickly here. Okay, frequency is the physical parameter. You know, you can measure frequency. Pitch is more your perception. You know, if it's high pitch or low pitch, because there's nothing about the frequency that says, oh, this is really low pitch. That's how your brain interprets it, low and high. And it's just, your brain could have wired it differently and you could have thought low sounded high, but it's how your brain interprets it. This fundamental tone versus overtones. Well, your hearing is 16 hertz to 20,000 hertz, and the hertz is how many vibrations in 1 second. So the lowest sound that you can hear is 16 vibrations per second. The highest sound you can hear is 20,000 vibrations in a second. Higher than that, it's ultrasonic. It's beyond your hearing capability. But bats make ultrasonic sounds all the time, and they're very loud sounds that bats make. And it's kind of interesting. Bats are always going, you know, they're screaming really loudly, and they scream so loud that they would damage their own ears. But they have a mechanism in place so that when they scream, their ear bones actually kind of, you know, pull apart a little bit to so they go deaf momentarily while they're screaming. Basically, they're trying to stop the transmission you know, during that moment that they're screaming, so they don't hurt their ears, and then they can hear the echo back. And that's how they're navigating in the world with sonar. And when we use sonar, we make very loud sounds, and the loud sounds that we make with our naval ships can actually damage the hearing of whales and dolphins and, you know, these animals that are also using sonar. Okay, so that's ultrasonic or subsonic, like an elephant call is subsonic to us. We can't hear it. Pitch of a different instrument, sound wave independent of frequency. That's actually kind of an interesting side note. The speed of a sound wave independent of its frequency. So these low frequency and high frequency sounds, they travel at the same speed, which is a good thing, they point out, because if you were in a concert setting and the frequencies traveled at different speeds, then it would mess, you know, if you were at the back of the auditorium, then maybe you would hear the flutes before you heard the bass, and the timing would get off. No. That would be unpleasant. It actually doesn't work that way. Different frequencies travel at the same speed, so that's good. Intensity related to loudness or softness. Whispering is about 20 decibels. Okay, sound quality. Vibrating objects vibrate in multiple frequencies, the lowest of which is called the fundamental tone, while the others are called overtones. So my voice, la, that's multiple frequencies at once. So the lowest one is the fundamental tone, and then there are overtones. And that's basically, you know, how you tell the difference between a banjo, bang, and a guitar string, dang. You know, they sound different to you. They can be tuned, you know, they're both, you know, a piano key and a trumpet and a banjo and a guitar, they're all playing one note, but they sound different. It's because they have different overtones. So they vary in sound quality. Okay, that's enough. You can find more explanation than that. Can you hear sounds in space? No. Well, yes, because you're wearing a space helmet and you have your own air inside of it. And so, yes, you can still transmit sounds through the radio to your ears, things like that. But there's no air to vibrate. So if your helmet cracks and you go, ah, well, you can't, because you can't scream. You can't go, ah, because as soon as you're, as soon as you get the crack in your helmet, the air is sucked out instantly from your body because you're in a vacuum. Huh. So you can't make any sound. You can't vibrate your vocal cords. You can't vibrate the air. So you can't scream. Maybe. But you can send radio waves as long as, but you know, you still need to make a sound to transmit. So keep your space helmet on. Sound can be reflected off of things. It can bounce off of things. If you're a sound engineer, this is a big deal. You know, if you're designing a sound system for your home, you're interested in how the sound is bouncing off of furniture and walls and carpet and things like that. Most of us don't pay too much attention, other than some rooms are echoey and some rooms absorb the sound, things like that. You can direct the sound with a little megaphone thing. You can gather sound. You can put your hands to your ears and literally gather more sounds into your ears so that sounds seem louder. You know, if you shout and the distance is far enough, you'll notice an echo. You know, if I'm just standing close to a wall and I yell, you know, the echo is mixing up with my own voice. I don't hear it as an echo. A little further away and, you know, I shout, hello, hello. You know, I notice the sound coming back there. You really gotta watch a video here. I don't know if it's going to show. I have no idea if the video of me is, oh darn it, my internet keeps going out. I have no idea if my webcam, it's really weird, this program I'm using, I can't see the webcam while I'm recording, and I only discover afterwards if I was in the recording or not. So it's lame. Okay, vocal cords singing. Search for vocal cords singing in case this video doesn't work. And this is great because they put a scope down different singers. And you probably won't get all of it because I'm going full screen here. Okay, so here are our singers, and you're looking through the scope that goes into the nose. And this is really good of them to do this for us. So we're going down four different noses here, and navigating through the nose, which is really uncomfortable. So they're good sports to put up with this. And then down the throat a little ways, we can see the epiglottis, which controls the flow of air. into the trachea. You know, the epiglottis closes whenever you swallow. So they're clearing their throat, and you can see the vocal cords just very thin. Those are the vocal cords right at the edges, the little V. Okay, so now they're going to start making sounds, vocalizing. Oh. Incredible. Oh, that's so beautiful. The control that they have over their vocal cords, using that as an instrument, and of course using the whole head as a resonating chamber. And you know, what talent. That's just beautiful. But anyway, the vocal cords are just vibrating, and you've got these various muscles for controlling how closed your larynx is, and tightening those vocal cords to make a higher pitch, or loosening them a little bit to make a lower pitch, and just, you know, bring them close together and forcing air over them. And it's really kind of interesting if you think about, why can a gorilla or a chimpanzee not learn to talk? Why do they? And you say, wait a minute, don't they do sign language? Yes, they do sign language. You can teach them some sign language. You can teach them to, you know, tap buttons on a computer. There can be fairly elaborate communication that goes on with a gorilla or a chimpanzee, but you can't get them to say hello, hi, anything, because they don't have breath control. They can't hold their breath and pass it through the vocal cords. They have vocal cords, they have lips, they have jaws. They should be able to make these sounds, but they don't have the breath control. So it's a strange thing that humans have this really good breath control. It's actually, okay, side note, there's an interesting video about the aquatic ape hypothesis. Is it a TED Talk? There's an old lady who's an evolutionary biologist. She's so funny. Yeah, it's a TED Talk where she discusses the aquatic ape hypothesis. And one of the... let me just see if I can find that really quick. If I'm searching for TED aquatic ape. Elaine Morgan. It's 6 years old. I don't know if she's still alive. We're not going to watch her talk, but you should watch it. It's really quite interesting. But one of the lines of argument for why she thinks that we had an aquatic ancestor is our ability to hold our breath, and that speech is a product of being able to hold our breath. So quite interesting. Okay. Music versus noise. That's the singers that you just heard versus me singing. So why is it that they have music and I have noise? They have good control over the making the vibrations very regular, instead of it going all over the place when I'm singing. So it's the regularity of it that pleases our brain. And some people are more sensitive to it than other people. And it's very, very subjective. So some people might say that I can sing. If you search for the world's worst singer, you get all sorts of things on American Idol and terrible, it's kind of sad. And this isn't actually what I'm looking for. Making fun of people, you know, it is kind of sad. But you know what? They're trying, and that's good. But this is still... Oh, here we go. Here we go. Here's what I was after. This woman, Florence Jenkins. Thank you. She loved to sing. And she sang and sang. She had a lot of money. And she's taking on the queen of the night here. Okay, so you should really, you know, listen to Queen of the Night from somebody who has better voice control. But what I love about Florence Jenkins is that she didn't care, and she sang anyway, and she, you know, and she had terrible critics, you know, but people came to hear her because she just loved to sing anyway. And I don't know if they came to laugh at her or what, but she said, people may say that I, you know, people may say that I can't sing, but they will never say that I didn't sing. So hats off to you, Florence. Okay. Musical instruments. Okay. Well, I'm going to let you guys read up more on that. I'm not going to talk too much about... These are just different ways of producing sounds. You know, we can vibrate a string, and then the vibration of the string transfers to a sounding board and out the air. We can vibrate air inside of a metal instrument like the woodwinds, like a flute, or we can vibrate a wooden reed that goes through the tube of the clarinet, or the saxophone. We can vibrate, we can buzz our lips and vibrate the air column within the trumpet or the tuba or the French horn. We can boom, 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 boom. We can hit things and cause vibrations of the air by striking an object. All the percussionist instruments, which can be a lot of fun. These are all different ways of producing vibrations. And, oh, there's a lady, percussionist, Evelyn Glennie, is that her? There's a great TED Talk called How to Truly Listen. This lady's deaf.
When you look at a piece of music, for example, if I just open my little motorbike bag, we have here, hopefully, a piece of music that is full of little black dots on the page. And, we open it up and I read the music. So, technically, I can actually read this. I will follow the instructions, the tempo markings, the dynamics. I will do exactly as I'm told. And so therefore, because time is short, if I just play you literally the first maybe two lines or so, it's very straightforward. There's nothing too difficult about the piece. But here I'm being told that the piece of music is very quick. I'm being told where to play on the drum. I'm being told which part of the stick to use. And I'm being told the dynamic. And I'm also being told that the drum is without snares. Snares on, snares off. So therefore, if I translate this piece of music, we have this idea. So on. my career would probably last about 5 years. However, what I have to do as a musician is do everything that is not on the music. Everything that there isn't time to learn from a teacher or to talk about even from a teacher. But it's the things that you notice when you're not actually with your instrument that in fact becomes so interesting and that you want to explore through this tiny, tiny surface of a drum. So there we experience the translation. Now we'll experience the interpretation.
Okay, well, interesting. So, good TED Talk, how to truly listen. Moving on, and I like that, the translation versus the interpretation. You know, having it literal, you know, just doing what it says on the page versus interpreting it and the musicality of it. Okay, Doppler effect is that the waves, because the train is moving, the waves are closer together in the front and further apart at the back, even though they're being sent out at the same frequency. So if the train's not moving, it just sounds like a train whistle. But in motion, you know, it think of a motorcycle traveling. Yeah, as it's coming towards you, you're getting a higher pitch because the frequency of the sound that's being compressed, because it's being the motorbike is traveling with the sound. You know, it's making the sound while traveling towards you, and so new waves are being made closer to the old waves. And anyway, so you get that higher sound as it approaches and a lower sound as it's departing. Lower, you know, it sounds lower as it's going away because the sounds are being made, you know, the thing's moving away as it's making sounds. That's the Doppler effect. And the Doppler effect, there's also Doppler radar. And do we even talk about that? I don't think so. Sonic boom. Strange. When an object's moving as fast as it is, creating waves in front of it, and the waves can't get out of the way fast enough. And you can hear this, you know, every time Mach 1, Mach 2, you get these shock cones. And I used to think that, you know, a plane went faster and faster and faster, and when it hit the sound barrier, boom, and then quiet. But really, that's because that's all I would hear as an observer, is the plane passing overhead, and I would hear boom, I'd hear one boom, and that was it. But really what's happening is everywhere the plane is going, it's making a boom behind it. So, you know, an observer here, an observer here, an observer here, miles apart, they're all going to experience the boom as the plane goes by. So if a plane is flying at supersonic speeds, if it flies low to the ground, it could go, you know, across a city fast, and boom, boom, boom. You know, everywhere it went, there'd be a boom, and it would be enough to break windows. You know, if the plane was flying low to the ground, you just shatter the windows in the whole town. So the boom is being made continuously, and now the person in the plane, yeah, they're not experiencing that. The sound's behind them. But Chuck Yeager was the first to break the speed of sound. There's a good movie about that, right? If you haven't seen, I can't even remember what it's called, but good movie about the first to break the speed of sound. And it's just, that's going to drive me nuts. It's not the Blue Angle. It would be the Blue Angel. Okay, so there you can see the sonic boom being produced. And yeah, they're going to do this over the water or over the desert or something, because they don't want to shatter windows. Sympathetic vibration. All objects have a natural frequency of vibration. And you can make that object vibrate without touching it. If you, that's not a good explanation of a sympathetic vibration. Well, sympathetic vibrations, the two examples that I'm going to give are the breaking a crystal with singing, and it can be done. And I'm sure you can find YouTube videos of people trying to get the right pitch to vibrate that crystal to where it breaks. And you can also look at things like the Tacoma Narrows Bridge and sympathetic vibrations of the bridge. And by the way, this is why when an army is marching across a bridge, they break formation. They don't march, because the marching can set the bridge to woo, woo, woo. And if you're marching at the right frequency, you can collapse the whole bridge. You can set up the, if you hit the natural frequency of the bridge, then the marching is going to cause it to go sway more and more and more. Here's a 1940s video. So it's not
a fatal day, and the wind begins to speak with a roar that no man can fail to hear.
It's not that it's such a strong wind, it's that the wind is at just the right frequency.
The feather span weaves like a ribbon in a swinging twist that you wouldn't believe possible unless you could see it as you do now. There's an automobile caught on the heaving roadway. The 11,000-ton feather span twists and strains the giant cables that support it.
Okay, so that's 1940 film. But it's not that the wind was so strong, it's that the canyon and the wind made it, it's just the right frequency for that bridge. And so the sympathetic vibration, it just started vibrating at the same frequency as the wind, and the bridge collapsed. I mean, it could only take so much, and it collapsed again more recently, I believe. Forced vibrations, when objects are in contact with each other, then you can cause a forced vibration. And they actually have headphones that, instead of going in your ears, they go against your bones, and it vibrates your bones, and that translates to sound. It's kind of weird, because these headphones, I can't remember what they're called, but if you put it up to your ear, you can't hear anything. But as soon as you put it to your bone, now you can hear everything just fine. And they use these for high wind situations, like if people are working on a bridge in a windy day, and the headphones, you know, you hear, there's too much wind interfering that you can't hear. But with these other headphones, with these ossicle transmission, I don't know what they call them, but I've used them once, and it's a weird sensation, but it's just vibrating your bone directly, and it sounds like normal. It sounds normal, even though it's not coming through your ear. Okay, so they talk about, if a bass of a vibrating tuning fork is placed on a table, the sound gets louder because the table's caused to vibrate at the same frequency as the tuning fork. Okay, so, you know, when you tap a tuning fork, you don't really hear much of anything, but then when you put it against the table, you hear it. You're actually vibrating the table. I don't think that's a great example. Maybe you can find a better example, forced vibrations. Detecting objects with sound, sonar. This is looking at the reflections and interpreting, you know, what are the reflections. So fish finders work this way. It's just the sophistication of the technology is interpreting the reflections. And I should say that's pretty similar to like a CAT scan in that you're interpreting reflections. In the case of a CAT scan, it's, you know, x-rays bouncing off of soft tissues versus hard tissues, things like that. But really, a lot of it's the software, you know, to distinguish, is that a fish, is that a rock, is that a submarine? And so the software, you know, it's about interpreting these reflected sounds. And just a quick story. Well, it's 45 minutes into this lecture. I better stop. But let me just tell you briefly that I know a physicist who works with like CAT scan machines and different hospital machinery that's all about interpreting the signal that's bouncing back. And he was studying the mathematical algorithms of the program, you know, trying to understand the math behind how the machine was interpreting the bounce. And he looked at all the equations and he thought, I think I could do better than that. And he wrote new math equations, and when he plugged those into the machine, it came back with a better picture, a clearer picture. And all he did was change the math equations, right? So he's just changing how the machine interprets the signal bouncing back. Well, he called up the manufacturer, I think it was GE, and said, hey, I've got this improvement to your machine. They sent somebody out. He showed them what his new equations did. And on the spot, the guy who they had sent out says, hey, okay, I will cut you a check right now for $750,000 if you will license that to us, if you'll give that to us. So just by knowing math and coming up with new math equations, this guy got $750,000 on the spot. Crazy story, but true. Okay, better stop there. Hope this worked. And I will be out of contact for the rest of the day unless you text me, because I'll be traveling more. Thanks and good luck. Bye.